This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. I am here today with Dr. Lee Jussim, Rutgers University. And, you know, I'm here talking to Lee partly as he's an academic. I know him through academic Twitter, and we will talk about his academic work. But first, I do want to talk about his experience with Hurricane Sandy several years ago in the greater New York area. Like many people, he was out of power for 5 days. And I think water as well, but we'll talk about that. It's as close to my heart in a way right now because, you know, I just came out of a situation where it was like 3.5 days, no power. There's water and electricity, water and gas, no electricity. So, we just came out of the Texpocalypse. A lot of people in Austin and other towns in Texas, cities in Texas, do not have water for various reasons, but the electricity is coming back to the grid. And, I think we dodged a bullet in a way. It could have been a lot worse, apparently, but it still was bad in a lot of ways, and we're still kind of picking up the pieces here. And I want to talk to Lee first to basically, hear, his experience and what it was like being basically a first world, academic who's, lives his life on the computer and then all of a sudden be thrown back to where he was. But first, Lee, could you introduce yourself to the listeners?
Yeah, sure. Hi. So I'm Lee Jussim, Razib. I'm delighted to be on here with you. I'm a social psychologist. I'm also chair of the Department of Psychology at Rutgers. I've been doing social psychology for like 35, 40 years. And I would, without going into all the detail in one fell swoop, let me simply say I am deeply skeptical of much of what goes on in my own field.
I mean, that's a really great introduction of your own field. But let's talk about the field of being a human and the university of life. So let's go back to Hurricane Sandy, which is a pretty big deal because Miami, Houston, obviously Louisiana and New Orleans when it comes to hurricanes. But then, Sandy hit. It hit the New York City area, New Jersey, parts of Connecticut, so it wasn't just New York City itself. And I actually asked another friend whether he wanted to come and discuss his experience. And he said no. And it was just because it was too traumatic. And Sandy is actually one of the reasons he does not live in New York City anymore. He had an academic appointment. I'm not going to say who it is, but he actually had an academic appointment at Rutgers, where you are right now.
Wow.
And he left. I mean, there's a variety of reasons. I can't say it's just Sandy, but I think that was definitely one reason where he's like, he's a New Yorker, but it was a really traumatic experience for him. And he wanted a different quality of life. He moved out to the West Coast and he's doing great now, living in a college town, the dream, right? And you live in a college town too, but it's kind of like in the greater New York City conurbation. So can you talk about, there are listeners from all across the world who do listen to this podcast. So can you tell us about where you live, about Rutgers, and then talk about the days before Sandy? What I really want to hear first is, what did the authorities say? Like, did they give you any clue? Because we here in Texas, basically we didn't get any real warning that it was going to be what it became.
Well, okay. So probably the most relevant thing for the Sandy part, Rutgers is in sort of a college town, but I don't live there. I'm like 25 minutes outside, and it's a basic suburban development. Just endless, single family homes, lawns of varying degrees of manicuredness. I actually played tennis the morning that Sandy hit. And that was because it didn't hit till the evening. And it was kind of like cloudy and maybe 50s and a little bit windy, not too bad. And New Jersey, there was nothing from the authorities. But what there was were the weather reports. But the thing is, the weather reports, 80 to 90% of the time, exaggerate the dangers of these storms. And that's because, you know, exaggerating the dangers probably serves both like a sort of a double purpose. You know, it's sort of like clickbait. People, it gets people's attention. They, you know, they make money. Also, I guess they might prefer to err on the side of exaggerating the danger, because then, you know, if people prepare for something unnecessarily, that's less annoying than failing to prepare for something when it was necessary. Anyway, so the reports were pretty bad. I didn't really believe them. But at the last minute, like the day it hit, when I was done playing tennis, I was like, you know what? This is sounding not like it's going to be bad, but it has a slightly higher risk of being bad. So I did a few minor precautions that turned out to really make a huge difference when it did get bad. So I really only did two things. I filled up the gas in all three of my cars, and, you know, I have these like gas filler, container things. So I did that to make sure, you know, if all hell breaks loose, well, could get by for a week on the three cars. And I stocked up on wood for the fireplace. And that's, you know, it was late October when it hit. You know, the prediction was for weather in the 50s down to the 40s overnight in the 30s, that it was going to get cold. And the worst comes to worst for both of these. We would use the gas and we would use the wood over the course of the winter anyway. That turned out to save us, because when Sandy hit us, it wasn't a normal, so I'm kind of in central Jersey. Like on the coast, it was really bad. Like there was, you know, the rising seas and whole communities flooded out and stuff. We're inland enough that we didn't get flooded out. The main damage was done by the wind and the lightning, which took down basically the power grid. So, you know, nothing was really all that wet, but everything went down. There was no electricity. There was no gas. You know, we have gas heat. And the water, I don't know if it completely went out, but it was reduced to a trickle that you had to boil before using. And with high daily highs in the 50s, you know, it takes a while for a house to actually lose its temperature. So we just threw on some layers. The first day or two, it wasn't really too bad. But by the third day, we basically lived by the fireplace, you know, the fireplace in the kitchen, where, you know, we would, you know, prepare food in the kitchen and work and sleep by the fireplace. So that's like an overview of what happened.
Well, so, you know, those temperatures, I mean, so those temperatures are like manageable. Like, was it the water that was more of the issue, I think, than the heat?
Well, it was all, you know, I mean, because it did last for us, it was somewhere between 4 and 5 days. I don't remember now whether sort of every thing slowly came back. It's not like everything was out for 5 days. And I no longer remember the sequence. But the heat was bad, you know, the lack of heat was bad. By the third day, you know, overnight, it's going into the 30s. So, you know, the ambient temperature in the house is probably the high 40s. When you're just in the house, it's cold. I mean, you're not going to like die from it, you know, but it was hard to even work because your hands are so cold all the time. So, you know, it just, and then sleeping was like, you know, it was like we were camping, you know, in the mountains in winter. I mean, it was just, luckily, when we were younger, we used to go camping all the time. So we had all this camping equipment, and between blankets and sleeping bags and layers, I would say the cold was the worst. The second worst was because there was no electricity. We had plenty of food, but there was a risk that most of what was in the refrigerator and the freezer was just going to go bad. And we did, you know, one of the things I did was I stocked up on ice, because we used to go camping all the time. We had all these coolers to bring food camping, and stuff that was at risk of going bad, we were able to move into the coolers. Plus, because it was in the 30s overnight, we could actually put stuff like in the garage or even outside on the deck. And between that, you know, we lost some stuff, but it wasn't really too bad. So I would say the cold was the worst. the boiling the water, you know, that's, again, that was very camping-like, because you often have to do that when you're camping. It's like, you know, you don't really have potable water, so you have to boil it. And it's like, it was a pain in the ass, but you know, we had done it so long, it was like, all right, this is sort of an unpleasant adventure that's not all that different than some of the other things that have happened, you know, like on a camping trip, so.
Well, I mean, so yeah. Did you talk to your neighbors very much? I wonder what the general perception in the community was of what was going on.
Yeah, you know, I mean, it hit all of New Jersey, so we knew it hit everybody that we knew. And it did, the power and the water and gas all came on, you know, at different times for people in different localities. And I think like the earliest that I remember coming on for some people was like the third day. Some people were out for a week. They were definitely out longer than we were. And, you know, the longer it went on, the harder it was, right? I mean, it just from the temperature standpoint, your place gets colder and colder that time of year. So you know, but people, there were a small number of people with generators. And, you know, everybody was jealous of the people with generators. They because the power went out, there was the gas stations didn't work. So as it slowly came back, you know, like one gas station would be open or they'd be open a couple hours a day. And the lines were horrendously immense. But because I had filled the stuff up, I just missed all of that. You know, we were good. And so people basically hunkered down and helped each other when they, you know, they kind of, there wasn't much most of us could do to help each other, but there was some of that. You know, we weren't flooded. So it's not like I was involved, you know, paddling in canoes and kayaks, rescuing people from flooded houses. Like that, it's just that didn't happen where we were.
Yeah, I mean, there were people who lost everything. I think I was more in Brooklyn, more in the city rather than New Jersey.
There was some, some of the Jersey coast got hit bad. Actually, my wife, Lisa, did some work post-Sandy, you know, kind of trying to help with some of the recovery efforts for people who kind of did lose everything. And, you know, that was on some of the communities on the Jersey Shore. So it was definitely bad in Brooklyn. I think it was bad in Staten Island, and it was also bad parts of New Jersey. But it was weird; it hit kind of the southern half of New Jersey worse than the northern half. So that's where the worst of the, as I remember it, I mean, it's a long time ago. Maybe I'm misremembering something, but I think that's where the worst of the damage was. Some roller coaster at one of the seaside resorts that was blown into the ocean, and there were pictures of it sitting in the ocean and stuff. So
yeah, I mean, I think one of the issues here is you live in the metropolitan zone of the de facto capital of the United States, if not the official one. You know, so I mean, natural disasters, they happen elsewhere. They don't happen in New York City. You know, like
no, that's actually not true, Rasim. We get hurricanes regularly. So in the 90s, we were hit by Hurricane Floyd. I think it was actually a tropical storm by the time it hit us, but it started out as a hurricane, and that caused massive flooding. I mean, like there are a couple of bridges over the major river here is the Raritan River, and the bridges normally are, I don't know, maybe 100 to 200 feet above the river. One of the lower bridges, the water was up to the base of the river, which I know this because I went out with my kids on bicycles to look at this stuff because you weren't supposed to be out in the car, state of emergency and stuff. So we rode down to this lower, smaller bridge that's normally maybe 50, 60, 70 feet. And the water was up to the base of the bridge. The cops eventually came, told everybody to clear off the bridge because they were worried the rising river was going to flood the bridge. So the hurricanes hit here, you know, I mean, on the east and the northeast, and really the whole East Coast. The East Coast gets hurricanes. The West Coast, you know, gets earthquakes. But yeah, we get them all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying, but I mean, a tropical storm is definitely different than a hurricane. Also, I do have to, this is not to, catastrophe compare, but, you know, the issue here is in Texas, it was cold. We were having lows of 10 degrees Fahrenheit, and the highs during the days were in the 20s. First couple of the days. So that was, and you know, you have better insulation up there in New Jersey and New York than we do here in Central Texas, right? So
based on everything I've heard, I mean, there was no reason for Texas to prepare for an Arctic like storm. So yeah, if a major earthquake ever hits New York, it's going to be far more disastrous than in California because New York's not prepared for that, right? I mean, this stuff isn't built for earthquakes. So yeah, in that sense, I have no doubt that it was much worse. Right? I mean, you know, we do get them. So there's not much people can do if you live on a coastal community and you get flooded. I mean, that's bad no matter what. But everything else, you know, the houses are insulated. You know, the heating, even the heating is pretty good for the most part. So it is true that we're just, you know, the authorities do prepare for snow. The streets get cleared of snow reasonably efficiently most of the time. So, yeah, I mean, the natural level of preparation here for that stuff is definitely much better than for Texas.
I mean, we didn't have any snow plows. Why would we? It's
Austin. right.
Exactly. There are years that never, it doesn't snow at all. And when it does snow, it's usually a very, very light sprinkling once or twice that doesn't stick. So it's irrelevant. Yeah. And it looked like, so I grew up in upstate New York when I was a little kid. And it looked like the winter wonderlands that I remember from when I was a kid. So that was just, it was not a good situation. I mean, there was snow in San Antonio. Okay, that's pretty crazy.
I mean, I've seen some of the pictures. I mean, it looked like, oh my God, it was shocking to see that in Texas. Yes.
So Lee, in terms of like the before and after, it's a fair while in the past for you now. You know, you're a little vague on you're self-admittedly a little vague on the details. Did it change your view in any deep way about the resiliency of your lifestyle, of your culture's lifestyle, of the local region?
Huh. Well, you know, personally, I have to say no. But the reason I'm saying no is because I have always been very resilient. I mean, I grew up, we weren't exactly poor. We were like a step ahead of poor, but like one step ahead of poor. So I grew up in a public housing project. Then we moved to this this illegal two-family home and, you know, Levittown, Long Island, which was sort of an armpit of Long Island. When you grow up without, there are huge, shall we talk privilege? One of these days I'm going to do an essay where I confess my privileges. And one of my confessed privileges would be growing up like that. Because one of the tremendous advantages you get when you grow up without stuff is you don't really need stuff. And that just plays into being resilient. It's like, okay, you know, this is really difficult and a pain in the ass, but like I've had to deal with things that are really difficult and a pain in the ass before. And it's like, it's not worse than a pain in the ass. So it's like not traumatizing. It's like, okay, we'll just get through this. We'll do what we have to do. And, I can just do without for a while. So that actually is one of the great advantages to me of growing up without stuff. So personally, it didn't. I would say it did contribute slowly to a growing sense that the United States is sort of deteriorating to something like a third world country. So I've visited, I've visited Europe, I've visited a whole bunch of third world countries. Some have aspects that are really quite nice, but at the same time, there's usually lower levels of infrastructure, there's lower levels of social organization. But, I don't wanna overstate that, because it was just one piece in that puzzle, sort of another piece in that puzzle was when I was doing my travels, before COVID hit and stuff. One of the places we went to was Cairo, actually, Egypt, sort of visited the ancient Egyptian sites and stuff. And the Cairo airport at that time was more modern than Newark. And it's like, what the hell is going on here? So that was like sort of another piece in that puzzle, you know, and as so let me also contrast it with this. So at the same time we were traveling, I'd been invited to these conferences in Europe, in the Netherlands and France and Germany and, you know, all this stuff. So, and just from a day-to-day standpoint, these countries were just, functioning really quite well. And it kind of seemed quite different than the functionality in the United States. And, we just had this, just from this experience, like I never studied this, I'm not claiming any expertise on that, but it was as if the United States had kind of, not completely fallen to, a country that is really, really struggling, but kind of halfway between is what it kind of seemed like. Like, sort of in between a first and a third world country. So and I would say Sandy, like at the time, I wouldn't have thought about it exactly in those terms, but that it took them 5 days to put, and 5 days was us. There were people it took longer than 5 days to put back together. Just didn't seem like a high functioning country.
I mean, do you think it's partly region, partly class?
I mean, everything is, we're social scientists, right? So everything is partly everything else. So, I live in a kind of upper middle class neighborhood now. And it took them 5 days to put all that back. So there may be a class element to it. And I think, you opened up with the story of your friend who's kind of fled New York. In lower New York, so with my sister-in-law, my wife's sister and her husband live in, had a place in the village, and they were driven out. I mean, it was bad. It was very, very bad in lower New York. The bases of apartment buildings were flooded. People couldn't get out for a while and stuff. I don't have lots of knowledge about that. I mean, I just heard a couple of stories and stuff. So that was bad. And, weather doesn't, at least with respect to New York, the weather doesn't discriminate based on social class. Obviously it was when Katrina hit New Orleans, the low-lying areas were obviously hit much worse, and those were predominantly Black areas. So, but where we are, the coastal areas that were destroyed by Sandy were people's often, these beautiful beach resort communities. So, at least with Sandy, there wasn't as much, and maybe not any, of that social class element that there were in some of the other things. So,
interesting. I mean, it's been a while now. I mean, nothing that has happened since then has changed your views then, I'm assuming.
I think if anything, that vague sense that for me, we began to articulate it about seven, again, this is mostly conversations between my wife and I. It's like, we'd be hanging out in Newark Airport and it would be dysfunctional and it would be dirty. And we had, previously been to Europe. And it's like, what is this, like a third world country? Now they have renovated Newark since then. So it is better than when we were doing it. But we had this sort of just informal growing sense that the country is just not really functional and kind of falling behind. And without going too far about it, I would say the sort of disastrous response to COVID, the unbelievably slow, ineffective response that's led to 500,000 people dying from it, is another, I realize there are other countries, there are other first world countries, that have had sort of a bad response, but I get all that, but that's just, it is another indicator of a highly dysfunctional sort of government and system and systems that are sort of failing to protect us from knowable threats.
Yeah.
And I know you've written about the COVID really pretty articulately.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I hope I have. I mean, there's a lot more to say. There's a lot more to do. I think COVID is going to be basically a whole discipline for about a decade as we try to figure out what happened. You know, I mean, that social science is going to be done. Social science, epidemiology, molecular biology, public health, everything is going to be done. So, you know, I want to pivot to what we know and knowledge because, you know, the way what I know about you, aside from your privileged domineering personality, is that, you know, you're a social psychologist, but you're a person who's actually made me much less confidence in social psychology. I mean, is that a little ironic?
No, I would say that is extraordinarily warranted is what I would say. Social psychology, there are, you know, I'm hesitating a little bit because there are some areas within social psychology that I think are credible. So I don't want to come across as if I'm dismissing the entire discipline out of hand. So I would say there's a small amount that you really can hang your hat on. And then there's a substantial amount that we know you cannot hang your hat on. And then there's this vast middle where we just don't know that, you know, there've been so many other, you know, bedrock findings that were, you know, that were shouted from the rooftops to generations of undergrads that have proved to be irreplicable. So that raises the possibility that things that haven't been subjected to these sort of rigorous tests of replicability, that we don't know whether those are going to replicate either. So there is this sort of vast middle where I'm not saying it's all, you know, bullshit, but it's like we don't really know which is bullshit and which is credible. So, yeah, that's my field.
Well, I mean, so you're pretty well known. You're pretty well known, I think, for stereotype threat, stereotype accuracy, that sort of a I don't know if I hate the word debunking because it's overused and it's very ideologically fraught, as they say.
Yep.
I kind of knew it was, to be frank, fake a long time ago. Just looking at critiques of Claude Steele's, I don't want to say fake. That's too pejorative, but probably not replicable. Probably, you know, a false positive. And so I guess, like, can you talk about, like, was stereotype threat, was that part of the funnel plot analysis, if I recall correctly?
Yeah. Well, so. Stereotype threat had just so many problems with it that I don't, but we don't know that it is complete bullshit. So I want to stop short of saying we know that it's complete bullshit, even though there were tons of problems with it. So for example, in the very, very first studies, what they did was they showed that African American students performed worse under threat than did white students. And, you know, threat is sort of being reminded that race differences in IQ, reminded of racial stereotypes, you know, those would be the kinds of threats that they manipulated. But they only got that when they did an analysis of covariance. So that means what they're controlling for in the analysis of covariance is their prior standardized test scores. So what that means is when black and white students perform equally under no threat, which was what they found, they're not really performing equally. What that means is that the pre-existing differences went unchanged.
Yeah.
That's what that means. So it didn't eliminate the differences. The differences stayed the same. Now, it doesn't mean there was no effect either, because by virtue of there being a difference controlling for the prior scores, that means, at least if you just accept the original studies at face value, threat did exacerbate the difference. So that's an effect, right? But so, and that's potentially an important effect. So you have that. So put that aside. You know, the original studies were all conducted in the era of basically small underpowered studies. And there's just all this work showing that the probability of getting statistically significant results vastly exceeds the power of the studies conducted in that era. So something's wrong somewhere. you know, if the average power of studies is 40% and 95% of the 95% of the literature is reporting significant effects, there's bullshit in there somewhere. There's like a lot of bullshit in there. And the thing is, we don't know exactly where. Now, what has happened is not so much with the race and stereotype threat, but with there were comparable studies on gender and stereotype threat in the context of math. And the idea, same thing, you activate sex stereotypes of women's supposed inabilities to do math or science. And this would, you know, the idea would be that stereotype would undercut women's achievement. And that was, again, a very famous study, series of studies conducted in the 90s. And those have, as far as I know, every pre-registered attempt to replicate those studies has failed. So pre-registered means the researchers articulate the hypotheses and the methods to be used in testing the hypothesis and the analyses they are going to use to test those hypotheses before they conduct the research. And the reason the pre-registration is important is, you know, it cuts out fishing expeditions that run the risk of, you know, having 10 outcome variables, you get a significant result on one or two, and you just don't report the other 8 or 9. When you pre-register it, it's much more difficult to have that kind of sort of selective reporting. So there have been tons of replications of the gender effect, but as far as I know, there hasn't been a single successful pre-registered replication of the gender effect. And if any of your listeners know of any, I mean, I'd love to hear about it. So it just gives me, now there is a very large scale pre-registered replication plan to test, you know, to subject the race and stereotype threat effect to very rigorous, high powered replications that was put on hold because of COVID. So that paper got an in principle acceptance as a registered replication report based on the pre-registration, based on the plan that the researchers presented to the journal. So they have green lights all around, but the last I checked in, which was about a month ago, they had to put the whole thing on hold because of COVID.
Well, I mean, you threw a lot of terms out there, and a lot of listeners will know what a lot of that means. I just want to like review really quickly. So, I mean, you know, you got a lot of researchers out there, thousands and thousands, who are searching for statistically significant results. And so if you don't kind of set the terms of the debate or set the terms of what you're looking for and what you expect ahead of time, you can have people dredging through the data and just find random associations that happen to be statistically significant. So that was what was happening 10 years ago, right?
Yeah. Right. For most of my career, that was... Again, that seems to have been a lot of what was happening. No one knows how much, and I'm not claiming I do either.
So, I mean, what do we believe in social psychology then? You're a social psychologist. Tell me.
Well, that is a great question. I periodically have you know, kind of flirted with the idea of trying to do some sort of assessment of like the most credible findings in social psychology. So there's actually a very sort of famous and influential personality psychologist, Brent Roberts, who has done this with personality. And the way he did it is he kind of almost used a snowball sample of researchers. He laid out what he thought were, you know, credible findings and then emailed some of his friends and they emailed other people to identify what things people believed in, you know, and why. And he has this long list, and I don't do personalities, so I don't remember what a lot of them are. So, but it's great. I really like the idea of doing something like that, but I've never actually done it. So that doesn't really answer your question. So what do I really believe from the literature? I believe, you know, I want to start with the things I really know well because I've done tons of my own work on them, although my conclusions are based on the sort of vast literature underlying it, not just on my own work. So Contrary to much modern discourse, people judge others primarily on their merits when they know what those merits are. So if you look, there's a vast literature on the role of stereotypes in person perception that addresses, do people judge others mainly based on stereotypes, that is, do stereotypes heavily biased judgments, or on people's personal characteristics? And their personal characteristics might be their accomplishments, say if they're applying to college or graduate school or applying for a job. It also might be based on their personality, if you're just judging personality characteristics or on their behavior. And, you know, people, stereotypes create, they bias judgments. And I'm not saying they don't, but those effects, the effects of stereotypes tend to be pretty modest. Certainly, I'll just leave it there. Whereas the effects of accomplishments or behavior or personality on judgments tend to be very, very large, some of the largest effects in all of social psychology. So that's, you know, there's so much stuff on this. I get this with explicit judgments. I get it with implicit judgments. It's like everywhere. So, and one of the reasons I consider it credible, even though none of that was pre-registered, is tons of the researchers who found it pretty clearly did not want to find it. It's like they're finding it over and above what they were looking for. Usually they're looking for stereotype biases. That's what the papers are usually framed around. That's almost always what's emphasized in the papers. Sometimes they manipulate personal characteristics, but they just consider it a manipulation check, as if it's trivial. But then when you just look at what they found, their personal characteristics have these huge, huge effects on judgments. So people didn't really want to find this, but they did. That's one of the reasons I consider it super credible. Plus, the effects are gigantic. You're talking about, you know, effect sizes corresponding to correlations of 0.5, 0.6, 0.7. These are just, you know, they're just gigantic effect sizes. So anyway, so that's one of the things I really believe in. Still sticking close to home, for years I did work on self-fulfilling prophecies. So self-fulfilling prophecy is, you know, if I believe you, Razib, are really smart, I'm going to treat you, at, you know, the way I would treat a smart person, and you'll respond to that, and you'll actually become smarter. You know, same thing, if I thought you were stupid, I would treat you like a stupid person, and, you know, through social interaction, you would actually become stupider. And that would really only matter if I was, say, your parent or your teacher or something like that. So those things also, as far as I can tell, they actually do occur. But again, those effect sizes are pretty small. And one, there's lots of reasons they're pretty small. But one is that people, you know, when you have objective measures of what somebody's actually like, those heavily influence people's judgment. So self-fulfilling prophecies, like stereotype biases, they do occur. They tend not to be that powerful. So I'm, you know, that's just stuff in my backyard. And I've talked for 5 minutes. So I'm going to shut up there, because there are other things I think you can bank on. But yeah, but those are things close to home.
All right. So, I mean, you have convinced me that there should still be a field called social psychology. And, you know, I mean, you know, there are professors, because of the way tenure works, there are professors who just get bored of their discipline, or, you know, maybe think it doesn't even work anymore, and they just go do something totally different. So it wouldn't be, you know, I want the listener to understand, it wouldn't be the biggest deal if you were just like, okay, this is not a field that exists, and I'm going to do something else. But, which I and like what you've been doing a lot. So, you know, you came, I don't know, say prominence. I'm sure among social psychologists, you're known. You've been department chair. You've been around for a while, you know. But you came kind of on people's radar because of the whole stereotype threat thing, which that has been something that's been in the media. It's still in the media. You know, I remember in the 1990s, Tim Wise would bring up stereotype threat in the context of race differences in psychometric performance. Yeah. And everyone was like, whoa, that's incredible. That's awesome. And, you know, case closed. Now that's solved. We don't need to think about it again. It was obviously a gotcha, you know? You know, I mean, there's ideological motive there. That's fine. But so that's what you kind of came to prominence with. But now, you know, I think, like, as it's proceeded, like viewpoint diversity and these kind of like arguments, and you know, you kind of have like a perhaps a pugilistic aggressive style, rhetorical style. I, honestly, I'm not going to lie. I don't actually perceive it that way at all, but I myself have been told that I have a particular style. So it might be I just can't see that because, you know, I'm not
going to lie. Well, yeah. Yeah, yeah. I mean, so that perception is certainly there. And look, if you prioritize truth-seeking as a scientist, and in my opinion, everything follows from truth-seeking, including justice and social justice. If you try to build social justice on false stories and concocted narratives, you end up with the Soviet Union and the Cultural Revolution. So it all starts with truth-seeking. Now, truth-seeking is still hard. It's hard even if you completely solve the problem of activist agendas and ideological biases. It's very hard. If you prioritize truth-seeking, and I think, I don't know what the numbers are anymore. I mean, I think there's less and less of that every year goes by across the social sciences. It still might be a majority of people, but it might not even be a majority. I mean, people will always posture that that's what they're doing, but then you can look at what they do and you can see that's actually not what they're doing. If you place yourself in the mindset that truth matters as a scientist more than any of this other stuff, it's very hard, at least it's hard for me personally, to resist calling bullshit on bullshit. And there is a lot of ideologically driven bullshit out there.
Yeah, I mean, so there is, you know, with your language, I will say I am going to have to select explicit content for Apple when I submit this podcast, but which is fine.
Well, bullshit is a scholarly term. There's a whole a cottage industry of work on bullshit. And let me see if I have. I think I might even have something up there already. I have a paper up at the moment called. This is published in the Executive Digest. So this is a business-oriented peer-reviewed journal. Confronting Indifference Toward Truth, Dealing with Workplace Bullshit. So this is an article that's open at the moment. I didn't have to open it for the for the purposes of this conversation. I had other reasons for having it open. And one of the reasons I have this kind of thing open is because actually over the last couple of years, like lots of other people, I've become seriously interested, social science interest in misinformation, disinformation, and part of that, you know, propaganda. And there is this sort of bullshit, this whole area on bullshit. So yes, I don't know whether Apple will allow you to not edit out my use of the term bullshit, but I am absolutely using it entirely in the scholarly sense.
Oh, no. I'm down with that. I'm down with that. So, I mean, we have the issue with stereotype threat. Okay, so you kind of went at that, and that was kind of, you know, I mean, this is like going at the idol here. A lot of people, I mean, they still talk about stereotype threat. It doesn't matter what you say. It doesn't matter, right? Like, they're still going to at it. But yes. Now you're moving to things like viewpoint diversity. And I mean, what is viewpoint diversity? I mean, I know what it is. And I think a lot of listeners know what it is. But can you talk about viewpoint diversity? Because that stuff sounds weird.
Yeah, I want to make a preliminary point, though. So, and that is, there is this sort of semi-scientific, I mean, there's a social scientific sort of holy trinity that is of which stereotype threat is one piece. The other two pieces are microaggressions and implicit bias. And the scientific foundation on which all three are built is exceedingly shaky. In all three cases, the narratives and real-world applications are based on highly dubious and uncertain science. And there has been a slow-moving walking back of the extraordinary and extreme claims in all three areas over the last like 10 or 15 years. So it's stereotype threat is important. I would say it's one of the pillars, but the work on microaggressions and implicit bias is at least as important. And probably the work on implicit bias is even more important because, you know, the world is now filled with what research has recently shown to be completely useless implicit bias trainings. So I just wanted to make that point. And,
well, I mean, it's useless, but it's useful for corporate ass covering. I will use that word because that's what. A lot of this is PR. It's marketing. It serves ideological or corporate purposes. I mean, the two are kind of merged into one right now.
Sure.
So, I mean, you know, the gap between me and you on a lot of these questions is like, there's no daylight, right? So I don't want this to be like a total like, oh, I agree with you, Lee. I agree with you. So here's where I like wonder about.
Or Razib, you know what's worth saying? I mean, politically, I'm on the left. I believe you're on the right. Like, I don't think either one of us are extremists, but I think it is absolutely worth saying that as scientists, we can see the science as essentially the same despite our political differences. I think that is worth saying.
Yeah, but I mean that's definitely a right wing view now. I mean, I know it's not really. I know it's not really. But if you surveyed your colleagues, what they thought about you politically, they would say you are a right winger.
Oh yeah, they have said that. I mean, different ones have said that. I mean, but they do say that. But that's because they are delusional, Razib. On the basis of me, say, contesting work on implicit bias or, you know, producing results showing that the stereotypes held by a certain group seem to be pretty accurate, or, you know, arguing online with somebody promoting some sort of ideologically driven bullshit, you know, at online, the appearance of people conclude that you are the opposite of what you criticize. So if I criticize something on the left, people leap to the assumption that I'm on the right. And I'm not criticizing it because it's on the left. You know, I'm criticizing it because it's bad social science. The problem is nearly all social scientists are on the left. So when, I'm not saying all social science is politically biased, but when it is politically biased, it's almost always going to be left biased because there are almost no right-wing social scientists out there. I'm not saying right-wing biases don't exist. Of course, the right is just, you know, the right as a, from a human psychology standpoint, as far as I can tell, biases left and right are more or less symmetrical. You know, that they manifest differently. The people, highly ideological, especially dogmatic people on the left have all sorts of biases as they do on the right. That's psychologically. Well, but in academia, there's for all practical purposes, there's no right.
Yeah, well, I mean, so Four Beers, Two Psychologists podcast, which, I like that podcast. I listened to it. They had a conservative psychologist on, and I joked with them because it was Clay Rutledge, who is a moderate Democrat.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, yeah.
So that was his further – and there's one guy I know. I'm not going to name him, but I had always assumed that he was – Republican, but one day I actually referred to, well, how come you didn't have this guy on who is Republican? Because I just got a sense he was conservative. He just direct messaged me. He's like, "Oh, I'm not Republican. I'm a moderate Democrat too. I just seem that way." It's just, and I was like, "Okay, so like, cannot find anybody come on."
What you're just describing is absolutely right, and it is a testament to how far left the sort of center of academic social science has gone when mainstream kind of center-left Democrats are delusionarily seen as extreme right-wingers. And this is well-known. This is a finding I actually do believe from social psychology. The more extreme one is in one's political views, the more one's view of one's opponents are distorted sort of in the opposite direction. So a moderate will look like an alt-right nutcase to an extreme left winger. The same moderate will look like a communist tankie to somebody who is far right. So Now, the thing is, again, because there's almost no right wing in the social sciences, what that means is that people on the center left are going to be viewed by many of their colleagues as right wing nutcases.
Yeah, I mean, I have a little bit of a lot of listeners know I have a little bit of experience, like in terms of the flip situation. I grew up in Northeast Oregon, where everyone, well, not everyone, but like, you know, it's 3/4 Republican. It's pretty conservative. And, you know, I've always been, I mean, I would say that definitely in the 1990s, I was socially liberal, quote unquote. You know, I'm not religious. I'm an atheist and all that stuff. So even though I was definitely back then a libertarian in my orientation, people would kind of be like, oh, yeah, he's pretty liberal, or, you know, he's pretty out there, because I was like, yeah, why not gay marriage, you know, back then.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously when I moved to the Bay Area, or, you know, here in Austin, it's, you know, it's different. And that's just the way the world is. That's just the way the world is. You know, your social group, and you kind of position yourself to where you are. I do think one of the things that, like, allow us to communicate in common currency is this old positivist belief that there's a truth out there, whatever your normative values are. This is common sense to a lot of people out in the world out there, but in academia, it's really changing a lot. And what I was going to say, though, before, you know, you talked about how, you know, we're different and all this stuff, in terms of agreement, daylight between us, yeah, we agree on this objective truth. But I kind of feel sometimes, Lee, that you are tilting at windmills, and, you know, for the Philistines out there, like Don Quixote, right? Where, you know, the ship has sailed. You know, the horse has left the barn. Yeah. And, like, what is the future of academia? Like, what do you see? Like, these things that you're talking about, you know, we know that this is true. But even, like, I know people in biology who talk about stereotype threat, and I point out the issues with the studies, and they know the statistics. And they kind of nod, but they obviously don't want to believe in it. And so then they conveniently forget what I just told them.
Well, yeah, this is all over academia. But so I would say, based on what I've seen of you, you are much better at predicting the future course of events than I am. I feel like I just have never been very good at sort of predicting how things are going to unfold. But, you know, I would certainly, the trajectory of academia that I see is the progressive replacement of activism, of truth seeking by activism. Now, you know, that's a weird, it's a little bit of a weird thing. It's less, it's in some ways, it's less of an issue in the natural sciences, because, but it is sort of is and it sort of isn't. So when a biologist does biological work, there is going to be a biological reality there. This is, I was just talking about this yesterday. The companies developing the COVID vaccine did not, you know, as far as I know, none of that is published in peer-reviewed journals. They didn't need peer-reviewed journals. Either the vaccine worked or it didn't. There's like a reality standard there. And you have that in many of the natural sciences. There's actually a reality standard. So they're constrained by that. You can't do as much of the sort of post-truth, everybody believes, you know, standpoint epistemology doesn't really work for apples going up and down. So, but when the academics in the natural sciences sort of, you know, this is paper that I, recent paper, the last couple of years, the title of the paper is Epistemic Trespassing. And what epistemic trespassing refers to is when people have expertise in one area, start pontificating about some other area as if they know what they're talking about. Your example of biologists, you know, kind of going on about stereotype threat sort of is an example of that, in that, you know, if they're acting like, well, you know, because they're biologists, they actually have any expertise to reach any conclusion at all about stereotype threat, that would be epistemic trespassing. That you have a lot of. You have, you know, even people in the natural sciences kind of adopting this sort of the sort of left-wing version of a post-truth world on issues of social science.
I mean, the story is you watch Blade Runner?
Yeah.
Yeah,
both. The old one and the new one. Yes.
I haven't watched the new one, but you know, the Tears in the Rain, that final scene, like the things I have seen, things I have heard.
Right.
And you know, it's just it's amazing sometimes. In terms of, you know, they believe in the science and then they trust the science as long as it agrees with their priors. And then, you know, so for example, psychometrics, it's a bunk science.
Yeah.
You know, every biologist will tell you it's a bunk science. All of a sudden, biologists don't understand range restriction when it comes to the GRE. You know, it's just like, oh, wow, I've never heard of that. Oh, okay. That's interesting. People who would quibble at genome-wide association, and like there are reasons to quibble with genome-wide associations that are below like 1,000 in sample size, depending on your effect size, will accept like a few dozen individuals in a study when it comes to the GRE all of a sudden, right? So it's like their standards really, really shift when it comes outside a domain based on what their priors are. I guess like the final question we've been talking for a while, final question is social science, is the study of society even possible? Because I don't get a sense that in academia, people are willing to push back against the idea that all judgment about social variables, social statistics are political. Because once you make them political and there's no political diversity, there's basically left-wing Democrats and Democratic Socialists of America. Okay, I mean that's kind of the range. You have a few token communists, like literal, like you know, communist types.
It's more than token.
So far more token communists than moderate Democrats. You know, let's be fair.
Yeah.
But in any case, so you have the distribution like that. So I mean, if it's all political, there is no art of the possible. You know what the probable is, and you know how things are going to shake. Yeah. So, this is a very pessimistic way to end, partly because I believe in truth, and I believe there's so much we could learn out there, but I wonder about the possibilities right now in, 2021.
Well, so, qualification on that is that there's lots of social science that's just not on politicized topics. So, most of the field of personality is not politicized. A little bit is, especially when it talks about personality differences between liberals and conservatives, but that's not most of what that work is about. You could do work on close relationships or stress and health. You know, there's just vast reams of social psychology that have their own problems and their sort of methodological problems, physical problems. It's not that they're free of controversy, but they're at least mostly free of the problem of ideological bias because they're not politicized topics. So again, it doesn't really give them a free pass, but it, because of the other issues, but they're just not subject to that one source of distortion. On the other hand, more and more just substantively, proportionally, more and more of the scholarly effort in social sciences is on politicized topics. And it is highly fraught. That is, there is enough example of false conclusions that are most plausibly interpreted as evidence of researcher bias leading to the false conclusions. There's enough evidence of that to cast doubt on politicized research on politicized topics across the social sciences. So that I would say people in general, conservatives in particular, you're likely to see this among, but really among outsiders in general, high levels of skepticism and even blanket dismissals of politicized social science are really, I don't know whether they're completely justified or not, but it's not an unreasonable response given to the ways in which the social sciences have conducted themselves. So put differently, the social sciences have earned a dramatic loss of credibility with respect to their conclusions on politicized topics.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, I would agree with that. Do you think, like, I want to end on an optimistic note. Do you think that there's a possibility for more objectivity, or just like more, you know, looking for truth in areas American scientists avoid abroad?
You know, I'll talk from experience, so I don't really, I don't really know. What I will say is this. When I have given talks and attended conferences outside, mostly outside the U.S., and really in Europe, I'm really thinking about Europe, I have seen much less of the sort of ideologically motivated antipathy towards results or ideas that kind of challenge, you know, the sort of American left narratives than I've seen in the United States. So I don't know if that, you know, so I don't know whether that answers the question or not, because I don't really know, is it true? I mean, I would, you know, we published last year a paper showing that, so like almost 10 years ago, this paper came out in social psychology showing that large numbers of social psychologists explicitly advocate discriminating against conservative psychologists. Like they endorse, like there was nothing hidden about it. Okay, so that thing has now been replicated across tons of fields and in tons of different ways. There's just a wide swaths of hostility to non-leftists in American academia. We recently showed the same thing among European philosophers, essentially the same pattern. So that, you know, that cuts against what I was just saying experientially, where when I'd go to these conferences, there was sort of less political antipathy. On the other hand, when we asked point blank, there's as much. So I don't really know. I don't know.
Okay. All right. Well, you know, I don't know is a good way to end for a scientist, which is what you still are. But whatever your colleagues might be, you still are that, and you will be that. So Lee, it's been really great talking to you. You know, I'll see you online. Anyone who Googles you can see all the stuff that you do. And it's been great. And, you know, I'm glad you're there to stand up for what you think is right, because there's a lot of people who actually agree with you who don't have your courage. So, end on a hopeful note of, you know, there's hopefully there'll be other people who will also step up. I mean, that, you know, I am kind of a pessimistic person, but, you know, I have been known to be wrong. So hopefully I am in this conversation.
Well, this has been a complete pleasure, Rosie. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, it's been great.
This podcast for kids. Yeah.